Hello and welcome to Good Game, the show for gamers, by gamers. I'm Junglist.
And I'm Barjo. Strap yourselves in and hold on tight, viewers, as we prepare for a lot of gamage ahead.
That's right, Assassin's Creed has to be one of the most anticipated titles of this year. We speak to not one, but two of its developers.
But for fans of Metroid Prime, the wait is over. Number three, Corruption, has hit Australia, but does the move to the Nintendo Wii with its control system do Samus justice?
And can you really become addicted to video gaming? It's a controversial issue. Lux talks to the experts to find out more.
And we take a look at the evolution of the sports game. Tennis for Two was the very first video game. It was made in 1958 on an oscilloscope by William Higginbotham.
Nearly 50 years of sports games coming your way soon, viewers, but first, can you name the retro game for this week?
Do not be disheartened. You must return the realm to nature's order.
I think they need a clue, Jung.
All right, Peter Molyneux from Lionhead Studios was working on this one. They're currently making Fable 2. He made this one nearly 15 years ago. Thinking caps on, but first go read the news.
Ah!
The Nintendo Game Boy has got a new attachment, a monitor that can measure glucose in the blood, essential for managing diabetes. Paul Wessel invented the device when he realized that his diabetic son Luke was always losing his monitor but never his Game Boy. Diabetic children using the device accumulate points for testing their blood. If their glucose levels are good, they can use the points to unlock games and new levels in a game. Families with an Xbox 360 will shortly be able to limit their playtime with a timer that can be downloaded from Xbox Live. Parents will be able to set the amount of time the console can be operated on a daily or weekly basis. When the timer is up, the console will automatically turn off. A survey by Worldwinner, an online games competition company, has measured the percentage of people from both sexes who play to win, hoping to find out whether men or women are more competitive. The result? It's a tie. Although the survey only measured what they call casual competition, almost three quarters of men and women labelled themselves competitive or very competitive, and more females than males seek out daily competition. Mark Wahlberg is scheduled to play the lead role in a movie version of Max Payne. The game is best known for its film noir style and bullet time. Wahlberg will start work on the film after completing his role on Peter Jackson's The Lovely Bones. The film is to be directed by John Moore of Behind Enemy Lines fame.
Good game!
Jung, what's one thing better than a badass anti-hero?
What?
Two badass anti-heroes. From the makers of Hitman comes Kane and Lynch Dead Men. It features a very engaging character-driven storyline with more swearing than a Quentin Tarantino movie.
Damn it.
That old took it.
Have you checked all of them?
Hey, what's happening down there?
You play Kane, an ex-mercenary who's busted out of death row by a syndicate called the Seven. Turns out you've got some unfinished business and you need to recover a briefcase from a previous job or your wife and daughter get killed. The Seven assigned Lynch to be your escort. He'll be making regular calls to make sure your family stay alive and you don't run off with the goods.
Lynch is normally a pretty nice guy, but every now and then he loses it.
What are you looking at? Jesus. Is that all you got?
Christ. Halfway through, you start to wonder which out of the two is actually crazier.
Other than the story, which is the best part of the game, it plays out how you'd expect from a third-person shooter. You move steadily through every level with an over-the-shoulder perspective. Left trigger allows you to zoom in and aim. The gameplay relies heavily on a subpar cover system, and I can't tell you how many times I died because it took too long to get in and out of cover.
Yeah, sometimes when you lean out to shoot, you hit this invisible wall, and this lasted throughout the whole game.
Worst of all, allies would come and sit right in your spot, which would push you out of cover, and of course that gets you killed.
All this doesn't help in a game that relies on difficulty for its length. There's only a small amount of levels, so content-wise, it's a pretty short game. But you die so much in these levels that by the end of it, you're sick of it. There's no way I'll ever play this game again, John.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you feel like you've played it 50 times before. And we have to mention the graphics as well. It was passable on the 360 HD. We reviewed the 360 version, but non-HD was terrible. And even on the PS3 through the HDMI cable, it looked shocking. One nice touch, though, was when you died, you start having flashbacks of people yelling at you. That was nice.
I won't stop hurting.
Yes, I see it, Daddy.
Yeah, yeah.
Beautiful, beautiful.
Yeah, it was a nice way of showing that how he regrets how his family has to live with the mistakes he's made.
When you die, one of your allies can give you an adrenaline shot so you can go on. This was another nice touch, you know, it's kind of like a second chance kind of thing, and it's absolutely necessary in a game like this. You gotta be careful though, still, you can't have your second shot too close to your first, or you can overdose.
There was a bit of speculation as to whether this game was going to get banned here. I mean, we have no R rating, and there's just so much swearing all throughout this game. Also, there's a level where you shoot into a group of innocent bystanders, and you're rewarded for that.
Yeah, I can't actually recommend this one, I'm afraid, with so many better options out there for shooter fans right now. The co-op was nice to have, with a second player being able to play as Lynch, but it didn't address the game's main issues. I think this is pretty much the definition of a six. It'll give you mild entertainment, but you can find better without much effort.
This is definitely an adults-only game, Jung. I can appreciate the effort that's gone into creating these characters. They're pretty cool. And if you do pick this up, persevere to the end where you have to make a very difficult and grim decision. I couldn't get past the cover system, though. I'm giving it 6.5 out of 10. Now, Lux tackles the thorny and often divisive issue of gamer addiction.
Gamer, you'd probably be mistaken for thinking that two issues dominate the gaming world. Acts of violence inspired by video games and people becoming addicted to games at the expense of their real lives.
When we look at somebody who's really dedicated to playing sport or studying hard for the HSC or maybe playing a musical instrument, we're considering that behaviour to be pretty normal. But when we look at dedicated gamers, society hasn't yet caught up to that being perhaps a normal behaviour. They're seeing that as still somebody avoiding social issues or other types of responsibilities, when really, it's just another hobby.
I'm here today with Damien and Paul, who are from the games industry, and Daniel, who's just completed his thesis in video games and social skills. Guys, given your background, do you think gaming addiction actually exists?
Yes, absolutely, unequivocally, it exists. I've seen it in my workplace, I've seen it in my students. We acknowledge it as a problem, and we also acknowledge that it's part of our business, that we create addictive structures.
What you're talking about is fundamental behavioural problems where a game becomes overwhelming, and I think you have to be clear that that's what you mean when you say gaming addiction, not the fact that people enjoy it and people want to play something, but the fact that people have an uncontrollable urge. So when you look at it in those terms, I think that gaming addiction absolutely does exist.
Games involve moral and ethical decision making, strategic thinking, reasoning, leadership, persistence, and time management. These are all skills which most game players would find as benefit in their everyday lives. So where does it go wrong for the gamer who sees themselves as addicted?
When we look at why people come to clinics for games addiction, we're probably actually looking at other reasons of why they come there. It's really based on people being unhappy or something going wrong in their lives that they can't control and they want a means of escape. And the games to them seems to be the answer.
For some game companies, it's in their best interest to have someone keep coming back.
Where's the responsibility though? Is it the responsibility of a company? A company's responsibility is to make money? It's a very difficult, complicated question, and I think the only real answer is to come down to personal responsibility. If you think you're going to be addicted to a game, then do your best not to play it. But I think that the mechanics of video games, because they're about risk and reward and choice and control, do attract a certain type of personality who... And I think some companies can exploit that.
So what do you think about that sort of argument?
There's been a lot of research done on video game addiction and whether the problems associated with gameplay meet the criteria for an addiction. And not very much negative consequences have been unearthed. I know people who are addicted to fishing, you could say, you know, if you're using the colloquial layperson definition of addiction. Whereas at the moment, addictions as a mental illness carry very significant consequences. People mortgage their house and destroy the security of their family and their future. You know, like people die of alcoholism and drug addiction. So is playing video games until 5 in the morning, you know, resulting in the same negative consequences enough to define a mental illness on it?
It's really just my sense that there's something there. There's something there that isn't there in other mediums. There's something there that isn't there in alcoholism and gambling and things like that, that connects with people differently and gives them something that they haven't had before. And I think that's where the real danger is.
Well, it doesn't seem like this argument's going to be solved anytime soon, but if you do feel your gameplay is getting a little out of control, here's some tips which you might find helpful. Take an MMO holiday. Give yourself a break and let your subscription expire for a while, especially around exams or a high-stress time at work. Mix up your gameplay. Ever thought of going back to basics and giving Tetris another crack? Put some time limits around your play and try sticking with them. If you're using games to escape stuff, you might need to face up to those difficulties and get the support you need. Remember, games are about fun, so let's keep it in perspective.
Jung, do you think you've ever crossed that line and played a game just a little bit too much?
Well, you know me, man, I just like to win, and some games reward you for playing more rather than playing better.
We're keen to hear your thoughts. Do you think you can actually become addicted to a game?
Have you ever rearranged your real life to suit your gaming life? How do you time manage your gaming?
Drop by the forums and leave us your post.
Coming up, Quarter Circle A.
Good morning, Mother.
Good morning, Father.
Good morning, Tor. Why, where's Thomas? Oh no, looks like someone's caught MMORPG madness. The scientists at WaggleMax Video Gaming Technologies and Turtle Egg Hatchery have developed a three-stage process for elimination of the MMORPG virus. Stage one, knowing MMORPG. In today's ultra-modern hustle and bustle, it's so hard to tell what horrible gaming malady will kill us next. Why, with the zerging pox, degenerative role-playing sequelitis, and cancer, death is just a keystroke away. The MMORPG gene originated in the Peru from mosquitoes afflicted by low-level debuffs. It was then spread to personal computers, aka PCs, aka personal computers, and again transmitted to human hosts via prolonged internet exposure. With the ticking time bomb of the MMORPG parasite lying dormant in our homes, is your family safe? Stage 2. Identifying Morpic. Does your child exhibit any of the following symptoms? Unintelligible coded speech patterns, association with strange interspecial peers, severe allergic reactions to sleep and or bathing, use of domestic animals as transport, or identifies themselves as a pally, bovine, shaman, or outer spaceman. If you've said yes to zero or more of these, there is upwards of a 150% chance that your child has been exposed to the MMORPG contagion. Stage 3. Eliminating MMORPGGR. Previous methods of curing the MMORPG syndrome were barely more than barbaric rituals involving radical surgery. But thanks to advances in medicine and the good game scientists at WaggleMax, the citizens of today now have access to treatment in proportion to the player's addiction. Treatment options range from the low levels, such as simply unplugging the subject's computer device, to the advanced and highly effective WaggleMax MMORPG Rehabilitation Clinic. So, what do you say, folks?
Why, I'm sold.
But I've heard that the MMORPG virus is manufactured by WaggleMax solely for financial gain, and that they don't in fact have any medical qualification. I agree with you, honey. Bravo, WaggleMax.
WaggleMax Technologies. Put on your gaming slacks. It's time for WaggleMax.
Good game.
Julius Caesar, Mahatma Gandhi, John F. Kennedy all fell victims to assassins.
And now the developers of Assassin's Creed are hoping next-gen console owners will fall victim to, or at least in love with, their game.
We caught up with two of the Canadian developers of the game and asked them what they were trying to achieve with Assassin's Creed and the development process behind the game.
God knows your lonely souls. You play an assassin named Altair.
This is based on the historical facts that we found about the assassin. So the term assassin actually comes from this clan of guys who came to be around the Third Crusade. And we read about them, we're like, oh my god, we have to make a game about this, it's too awesome. So anyways, as Altair, you start out as a master assassin, but then you mess up your first mission. And you spend the rest of the game trying to gain back your honor.
Is Altair good or bad?
He's got an inner struggle about that, really. And it's part of the narrative structure of the game. I wanted the character that is, yes, he's an assassin, but he's not a murderer. Being an assassin and you kill, and then your target is telling you, yeah, but I'm not evil. So, you know, who are you to judge me? And that's part of who the character is having this inner struggle about, yeah, am I doing the right thing by killing those people?
Where did the idea for Assassin's Creed come from?
Coming from Prince of Persia, this time around I wanted a character that in his title you can imagine an action. So I remembered a book I read back in college about secret societies, and the first chapter was about assassins. At the beginning we were asked to do a game for Next Generation and to redefine the action-adventure genre on the next-gen platform. But in 2004, when we started, we had no clue, really, what was going to be Next Generation. The only thing we knew is that we had beautiful graphics. That would be, like, a given, right, because of the technology. But say, if we have only, like, beautiful settings with nobody in it, you know, we're not actually going forward. So I said, I would like to have a crowd. And the goal numbers at the beginning was 35. The 35 NPCs on screen. The 35 became 45, 65, and the end product, we have 120 NPCs on screen, which is great. And, you know, a lot of animation, more than 10,000 animation is composed the game, I would say.
How important was the historical accuracy during the development process?
The historical side of things was extremely important. So we started off by working with one historian who did all of the background research for us. He gathered hundreds and hundreds of images, plans of Jerusalem, Damascus, Acre, the cities where you would be playing. And then he gave a big presentation to the team with just habits, what the people did, what the population makeup of the cities were. And so then the whole team had this ground level understanding of the time period, and especially the year 1191 where the game takes place.
What's the balance between action and investigation in the game?
For sure we have a structure. So when you enter a city, it's all about first investigate your target. But how you do it, you can be really, really socially accepted and being as stealth as possible, or you can go and try to, you know, assassinate every soldier that you see. And the only place where the action really, really, really is important, and it's almost the only way out, is once you assassinate your target. And the entire city knows. Everybody's trying to get you, and it's get out of there.
You can go anywhere in the world, but how important is the story to the game?
The story is more important than in other sandbox games. It's something that I try to translate, but in French it really works well, but it's more like a flower box game than into like a sandbox game. So a flower box sometimes, you know, it's more linear, but in the middle you can put any flowers that you want. So it's a little bit the same thing in Assassin's Creed. It means that, yes, you can play and do a lot of stuff, but everything that you'll do will basically tell you the same story. And it's an action-adventure game. It's not only a sandbox game. And for me, it was important that we still tell a story because, you know, storytelling is one of the most human skills.
What do you think will be the most rewarding thing for you personally after release?
What I'm really looking forward and what I think people will do is we'll do their own movies of Altair, of one particular mission, and put that on YouTube, for example, and we say, oh, you've done it like that? Great, okay, yeah, I didn't imagine I could do it like that, so. And yeah, that's what I'm really proud of, this ability for players to really have their own experience. I like to say that you're the co-creator of the experience with Assassin's Creed.
Welcome to Esports Tonight, your guide to the history of the sports game.
That's right. In fact, video gaming kicked off with a sports game, and we're not talking about Pong. It was Tennis for Two, written on an oscilloscope way back in 1950.
Oh man, that's nearly 50 years ago. But what's happened since then? Let's get a replay of some of the best and most influential games, one sport at a time. What's first, Badge?
How about American football?
Oh, right up my alley. Most of the early game developers were American, so it's no surprise they turned to their national pastime for inspiration. One of the first was Atari Football on the Atari 2600 in 1978. Rather than models, the game only gave you knots and crosses to represent the players on the field. But to its credit, this was the first arcade game that used a trackball.
Not a bad thing in its day. Another big game in the arcades was Tecmo Bowl. It was developed by Tecmo, of Dead or Alive fame, in 1987 and was the first of a long-running series. It brought a new degree of realism to sports games by getting the rights to use real player names, and the gameplay was extremely easy to pick up and learn. It was fast, fun, and furious, and you'll find this game on almost all of the best game of all time lists. Nowadays, it's all about more realism and Madden! Over to you, Jung.
Next up, soccer. Over to you, Badge.
Considered one of the best games of all time, Sensible World of Soccer was released in 1994 by Sensible Software. The game gave you a nice wide view of the pitch when playing matches, and a simple control interface that let you pull off heaps of moves. However, the best part came off the pitch, where the developers recreated almost all of the leagues and divisions in the world with up to 26,000 players to choose from, to buy or to transfer to your own team.
Epic! Nowadays, soccer is dominated by two heavyweights. EA's FIFA series, which has the license to recreate all the world's top players and clubs, and Pro Evolution Soccer, which tries to offer a more technical challenge and is extremely popular in Europe.
Let's throw to basketball!
It wasn't the best, but NBA Jam was one of the most influential basketball games ever. Why? Because while most games were focusing on providing more realism and simulation, NBA Jam went the other way, allowing you to do some ridiculous slam dunks, crazy fast passes, and was also home to the famous line, "He's on fire!" Your turn in the ring, Badger. How about boxing?
Ah, now there's one game that stands out above the rest. Mike Tyson's Punch-Out. The original Punch-Out arcade games were great with an easy learning curve and digitized voices. But when it came to the Nintendo Entertainment System in 1987, it had a special edition. If you got to the end, you got to fight Iron Mike himself.
Wow, he was a tough one.
So, we've had lots of professional sports. What about extreme sports?
Ah, the first game to launch extreme sports games into the mainstream was an absolute classic. California Games was released by Epics in 1987 on the Commodore 64 and Apple II. You could do things like surfing, skateboarding, frisbee, and hacky sack.
Ah, the good old days.
So what's the story now?
The sports game genre is dominated by one company, EA. Using their EA Sports brand, they've signed exclusive licenses to use many major sports leagues and players, and their annual release schedule of games like NBA Live, FIFA, and Tiger Woods has dominated the competition in the simulation sports category.
On the other hand, there are plenty of other non-serious sport game developers out there, with the best example being Wii Sports, aimed directly at the casual gamer.
Time to wrap up this brief. Wrap up.
From Esports Tonight, well played and good game.
Good game.
Metroid Prime 3 Corruption is the first Metroid game on the Wii and the third and final in the Metroid Prime trilogy. You follow Samus as she tries to stop space pirates from corrupting various worlds with Phazon, a mysterious radioactive material. After an encounter with a dark version of herself, Samus also becomes corrupted, gaining new abilities, but at the cost of health.
Corruption is a first-person action-adventure style game. The action part comes from the Wii's new control system. You can use the Z button to lock onto your enemies and the Wii remote to aim your gun around. There's also some nifty controls like being able to thrust your nunchuck forward to rip off enemy shields with your grappling beam.
The adventure part takes up a lot of the game when you're not zapping aliens. As in typical Metroid style, there's a lot of puzzles to solve, and you'll be looking for a lot of upgrades on various worlds. When you get these upgrades, you can then go into new worlds. And typical of Metroid, you'll have to do a lot of backtracking to get to these new areas.
It's got space pirates. You must love this game.
Junglist, I live for space pirates. You know, but the only thing which is new in the game, essentially, is the control system. It's got improved storyline, and you don't have to count your laser beam ammo anymore, but basically it's a carbon copy of the GameCube versions.
But that's the thing, it's still a good game, even if it is a carbon copy of the previous ones, which were all great games, and this is a sequel anyway, so what's the problem?
Yeah, that's true, but I was hoping they'd freshen up the series a little bit. It's meant to be an action-adventure, and if you like the adventure side of things, that's great, but you're going to find yourself frustrated by the difficulty in the platforming side of things. However, if you like the action side of things, you're going to be annoyed that you have to stop and scan all the time. The only people that I can guarantee will truly like this game are Metroid fans. I'm giving it 7 out of 10.
I don't see a problem with it. It's a complex game that'll give you lots and lots of hours of gameplay, with the added bonus of if you finish the game 100%, you get an extra ending. The Wii's been aimed at the casual gaming market, but this proves that it can satisfy the hardcore gamers as well. I should also point out that sometimes doors take a long time to open. This isn't a bug, this is just a feature used to mask the loading times of the next level. All in all, top game. I'm giving it 9 out of 10 rubber chickens.
So gamers, did you guess the game for this week? It was Magic Carpet, considered a classic by those who played it. It had terraforming technology that was way ahead of its time, allowing you to reshape and manipulate the landscape in order to gain mana from the land.
It never achieved commercial success due to its high system requirements, multiplayer requiring a network card, and being one of the first games distributed on CD-ROM. It probably also didn't help that its main competitor at the time was Doom.
Time for us to go now, Jung, but don't forget to tune in next week as we get our hands on Crysis, which has some high-end PC users very excited.
Assassin's Creed is reviewed as well, and we'll take a look at the arcade. It's where gaming gained mass popularity back in the 70s, but now with over 3/4 of Australian homes having a gaming device, is their future in doubt?
And one of the all-time greats of gaming gets a new outing, this time on Next Gen. Mario Galaxy is supposed to be the first true successor to the classic Mario 64. We handed some chickens.
Till next time, gamers. Junglist out.
Bajo out.